I don't know what her very first words were, but when she was, she must have been 15, no, or 14 or 15 in Oxford, in her mother's house, she wrote a play which was produced in New College Cloisters, and there they all are, the cast, with Jack and my father, who was a great friend of his, also in New College. And so she had it in the blood. And she, they had plenty of money. That was very important. So her family wasn't at all wealthy. They were very comfortably off, and her mother had been an heiress, but she didn't have a lot of money. But my father did have a lot of money. Not he wasn't enormously rich, but he was very comfortably off, and they had servants. And she left things to servants. We were brought up by nurses, by a nurse and a nursemaid. And occasionally, I think, two nursemaids when there were five little children squawking away.
Would she be locked in a room writing?
And she would lock herself in a room. Okay. She had a huge desk downstairs in Rivercourt. Rivercourt is now, where she lived, is now belongs to the school there. And later, during the 1930s, an avant-garde architect called John McGregor designed, and they had built, a building in the back of the garden which had a squash court for my father, and down below they had a study for my mother and then a garage for the car, what she wanted was peace and quiet, a desk, and bars in the walls for her. I think what they were then called Swedish exercises, where you hang from your arms and you swung around. So she did that as well. And she liked that sort of thing. She was always a keen swimmer.
And what about her African connection?
That was much later. Was that perhaps after my father died, even, it might have been, or around that time. She'd always been keen on the people of the empire, so to speak. She inherited part of that from her mother, who was a real old Tory and an imperialist who had, you know, thought the British Empire was the greatest possible thing. And of course my mother hated all that, but at the same time she was completely part of it in a way. She just didn't want it to be bossed around by whites, but she thought all these coloured people were lovely. So the British Council sent a group of people round from Africa to visit her in Scotland. She did quite a lot of that. She liked being hostessing. She liked hostessing, and she liked explaining what a great character she was. Terrible show off. And one of them was the hereditary chief elect. I mean, he hadn't inherited yet, but he would be, of the Bangwa in what was then, no, was it Bechuana land, or it had been changed by then into Botswana. And she sort of kind of swept him off his feet and said, well, I'm coming to visit the tribe now. So she did that for every year for a long time. And she was nice to tribal people, the members of the tribe, when they came to Britain, as they did, to train as nurses or whatever, especially the young women. And she talked to them about birth control, which she thought she knew a lot about. And I expect she was getting a bit rusty by then, but at any rate, it was encouraging them in the right direction, and so on.